With this broadcast, we begin the 10th main division of demonology, which is demonic control. Sometimes this is spoken of as demonic possession. We're going to call it demonic control for reasons I'll explain in just a minute. So 10th main division of demonology is demonic control. We're going to discuss demonic control in 6 points. First of all, a definition. How do we define demonic control? What do we mean by demonic control? In order to arrive at a clear definition of demonic control, we must first deal with the key word and then a key expression. First of all, a key word, and then secondly, a key expression. The key word is daimonizomai, and daimonizomai is spelled daimonizomai. The word daimonizomai simply means to be demonized. Daimonizomai means to be demonized. It means to be controlled by a demon from within. This is the word that is frequently translated that such and such was possessed by a demon. The problem with the translation of demon possession is that the Greek word for possession is never used in conjunction with demons. The Greek word for possession is not found. What is found is simply daimonizomai. So rather than defining the term or translating the term as demon possession and then give the concept that such and such is being owned by a demon, it would be far wiser to simply translate it as demonic control. The best definition of the key word, which is daimonizomai, is demonic control. One is controlled by a demon. This key word is found in the Greek text of Matthew chapter 4, verse 24, Matthew chapter 8, verses 16, 28, and 33, Matthew chapter 9, verse 32, Matthew chapter 12, verse 22, and Matthew chapter 15, verse 22. Elsewhere, it's found in Mark chapter 1, verse 32, and chapter 5, verses 15, 16, and 18. An example in Luke is chapter 8, verse 36. An example in John is chapter 10, verse 21. The key word, then, is daimonizomai, which means to be controlled by a demon or demonic control. Now, the key expression that means the same thing, though the word itself is not used, is to have a demon. The key expression used in Scripture is simply to have a demon. The emphasis of the key expression is on residency. The emphasis of the key word is on control, but the emphasis of the key expression is on residency, in that in demonic control, the demon is residing within that person. And this key expression is found in Matthew chapter 11, verse 18, in Luke chapter 7, verse 33, in John chapter 7, verse 20, chapter 8, verse 48, chapter 10, verse 20, in the book of Acts, in chapter 8, verse 7, and chapter 16, verse 16. Now, combining the key word and the key expression, we can derive to a specific definition. By definition, demonic control involves a demon residing in a person and exercising direct control over that person with a certain degree of derangement of the mind and or physical upset of the body. Again, demonic control can be defined as a demon residing in a person and exercising direct control over that person with a certain degree of derangement of the mind and or physical upset of the body. Now, if we break this definition down, we can see the usages of the key word and the key expression and then the results of it. Again, demonic control involves a demon residing in a person And that part of the definition emphasizes the key phrase where the emphasis was on residency. And exercising direct control over that person, here we see the key word daimonizomai being emphasized. And then the rest of the definition gives us the results of a demon residing in a person and exercising direct control, where a certain degree of derangement of the mind and or physical upset of the body. A good example of where we see this definition actually in use and in practice is in Matthew chapter 12, verses 43 through 45, which talks about the demon's place and emphasizes both the key word and the key phrase. Then in Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 20, we have the results of demonic control, both in the physical and mental aspect. Now, to even get a clearer definition of what we mean by demonic control needs to be distinguished from two other types of demonic activity. One type that demonic control must not be confused with is demonic harassment, where a demon is harassing a person and the harassment comes from without. An example of demonic harassment is Romans chapter 15, verse 22, and 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 18. In these two passages, it speaks about the aspect of hindering, where Satan can hinder the plans of a believer. And this is demonic harassment, when the demons hinder the work of a believer. But demonic harassment comes from the outside. A second type of demonic activity that must not be confused with demonic control is that of demonic influence. We see that in Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 through 23, in the case of Peter, where after Jesus has made the statement that he is going to die, Peter says, "No such thing will come upon him." And then Jesus turned around, and facing Peter, he said, "Get thee behind me, Satan." Because it was obvious that trying to keep Jesus from the cross was a work of Satan. And at that point, Peter had been influenced by Satan to try to dissuade Jesus from going to the cross. So demonic control should be distinguished from both demonic harassment and demonic influence. Both demonic harassment and demonic influence are demonic activities outside the person, but demonic control takes place inside the person. In light of our definition, then, the question is, can a demon control a Christian? Can a demon control a believer? Normally, this question is phrased, can a Christian be possessed by a demon? But as I tried to point out, the word possession is not a good word to use because the Greek text never uses that term. And if we mean by possession ownership, the answer is no. A believer can never be possessed by a demon in the sense of ownership. According to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20, the believer has been purchased by Christ. He is owned by Christ. A believer can never be owned by Satan. He can only be owned by Christ. But again, the biblical usage is control from within. If we ask the question, can a believer be controlled by a demon from within? Here we must answer, yes, he can. And there are two very key places where this is clear. For example, in Acts chapter 5, verses 1 through 4, where we read of the case of Ananias and Sapphira. And as Peter is facing them, he says to them, "Why has Satan filled your heart?" Using the same Greek word that Paul uses in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18, where he speaks about being filled with the Spirit. To be filled with the Spirit means to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. To be filled with Satan means to be controlled by Satan, And so indeed, we can see that the Bible does teach that a believer can be controlled by a demon from within. A second passage is Ephesians chapter 4, verse 27, where Paul writes, "Don't give a place to the devil." And the Greek word that Paul uses is the Greek word that means a beachhead. When an army attacks, it first of all sends in soldiers to control a beachhead, and once they control a beachhead, the reinforcements can come in as those in the beachhead give cover fire. But remember, a beachhead is an area of control within enemy territory, and so a believer can be controlled through a beachhead within. So yes, a believer can be controlled by a demon. The distinction between believers and unbelievers is not that a believer cannot be controlled, an unbeliever can be controlled. The difference is a matter of extent. An unbeliever can be totally controlled, but a believer can never be totally controlled, only partially controlled. And as to the objection, how can a demon reside in the same body with the Holy Spirit? Don't forget, the Holy Spirit coexists with the believer when the believer still has his sin nature. The point is that the believer has two natures, and the Holy Spirit resides in the new nature, not in the old sin nature. And a demon resides not in the new nature, but a demon resides in the old sin nature. The fact that there are two natures coexisting within the believer shows why both a demon and the Holy Spirit can coexist within the believer, because they reside in two different natures. One last thing about, by way of definition, is that demonic control can be repeated more than once, as we see in Matthew 12, verses 43 through 45, and Luke 11, verses 24 through 26. And to summarize, demonic control is a demon residing within a person, exercising direct control over that person with some degree of derangement of the mind or causing some physical problem. We also pointed out that if we understand what is meant by demonic control, it is true that both believers and unbelievers can be controlled by a demon from within. The difference is the extent of control. An unbeliever can be totally controlled by a demon, but a believer can never be totally, only partially controlled. Now, the second thing to deal with under demonic control is the area of symptoms. What are the symptoms of demonic control? How can we tell if someone is or is not controlled by a demon from within? Now, before we move into the symptoms, let me first talk about something to keep our perspective in balance. These symptoms of demonic control I am about to discuss by and of themselves do not prove that demons are residing in the person. These symptoms in and of themselves do not prove that a demon is controlling, because there may be other problems that cause these same symptoms. So because a person has one or two or three or four, even five of these symptoms, is not evidence, definite evidence, that that person has a demon within him. There must be a totality of symptoms present to indicate true demonism. So let's keep our balance, not go overboard in one direction or the other. On one hand, let's not go to the extreme that says there is no demonic activity today. On the other hand, let's avoid the second extreme where we blame demons for virtually everything. So what are these symptoms of demonic control? Well, one symptom is a physical disease, as is the case in Matthew chapter 9, verses 32 and 33. But again, not all physical diseases are caused by demons, and Acts 5, verse 16 distinguishes between those who are demonized and those who are simply inflicted by physical disease apart from demons. A second symptom is mental derangement, as we can see in Matthew 17, verse 15. But again, not all mental derangement is caused by demons. And in Daniel chapter 4, verses 1 through 37, we do see a case of mental illness which was not caused by a demon. A third symptom is a deep depression, a dark cloud of depression. Now again, there are normal periods of depressions that people have. When someone has a failure in business, he's apt to get depressed. When someone fails a test, he's apt to get depressed. These things in and of themselves do not prove demonism. In the case of a depression caused by a demon, you can sense it. You can walk into a room and all of a sudden you feel this dark cloud of depression, and that is the symptom that I'm talking about. A fourth symptom is self-reproach. Demons like to lie to a person and emphasizes his lack of self-worth, and self-reproach can be a symptom of demonic control. A fifth symptom is suicide. Demons sometimes try to kill the individual they are residing, and suicide could be a symptom as well. So someone who has a lot of suicidal tendencies, there's made more than one attempt on his life, that could be a symptom, though again, by itself, is no evidence. Sixthly, passivity can also be a symptom of demonic control. Someone who consistently lives in a passive state, a person doesn't seem to be affected by anything going on around him, that too could be a symptom. A seventh symptom is immorality. Demons are unclean spirits. They're characterized by uncleanness, and so they drive those they control to acts of uncleanness, and so immorality is another possible symptom. An eighth symptom is bitterness, and a constant attitude towards bitterness against everything and everybody, against God, the world, and whatever, this too can be a symptom of demonic control. A ninth symptom is drug abuse, because drug abuse and the passive state seem to go together. And if you ever walk down the busy city street, you can sometimes see someone walking towards you who is obviously high on drugs. He may be looking at you, but he doesn't see you. He has become totally passive, more or less, and drug abuse that influences passivity can also be a symptom of demonic control. A tenth symptom is psychic power. People that seem to have psychic power, that seem to know what is going to happen, that too can be a matter of demonic control. I have not had to deal with many cases of people with demonic control. I would say all of my years of ministry, I have run into maybe 4 or 5 people that had a demonic problem very clearly. In the case of one girl that I knew, every time you walked into a room where she was, you would suddenly feel this dark cloud of depression I mentioned earlier. And when she's in a room by herself, she had a tendency to keep all the lights out, and you would walk into a room not knowing she's there, flip the lights on, and suddenly startled to see someone right there sitting, and with an attitude and expression of face as if she was caught doing something wrong. In the case of another girl that had a demonic problem, this girl always seemed to know something in advance. She seemed to have unusual psychic abilities, psychic powers, so that if the doorbell would ring, though from where she was sitting there was no possibility of her knowing who had come to the front door, she seemed to almost invariably know who that was. Psychic power is a real symptom. An 11th symptom of demonic control is animal-like tendencies. In a case which include one of these girls that I referred to a few minutes ago, she would buy a whole chicken and already cooked and then devour it with her fingers so rapidly as if a hungry animal was devouring it, and had animal-like tendencies in her eating habits. A 12th symptom is restlessness during Bible reading. Demons do not enjoy hearing the Word of God. It tends to drive them away. It tends to make them agitated. So a person who seems quite calm and yet suddenly begins to get extremely agitated when the Bible is read, this too could be a symptom of demonic control, restlessness during Bible reading. And the 13th symptom that I might mention is that of multiple personalities. Demons have a way of being able to take on the characteristics of other people. And so often in multiple personalities, what you have happening is more than one demon residing in a person. And at one point, one demon speaks, another point, another demon speaks, and you have these sudden changes of personalities. So these are 13, and these are not necessarily all, but these are 13 symptoms of demonic control. And again, we must be careful not to become demon inspectors, not to go around assuming people are demonized because they have maybe 2, 3, 4, 5 of these symptoms. There are other causes for these very same symptoms. Only when you have a totality of these symptoms can you conclude that such and such has a demon. Now, a good example that shows the multiplicity of these symptoms of a person that was controlled by a demon is the demoniac of the Gadarenes spoken of in Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 20. And in describing this particular demoniac, this person controlled by a demon, Mark points out 8 specific symptoms this one had. In verse 2, there was demonic indwelling. In verse 3, he had unusual physical strength. Thirdly, in verses 4 and 5, he had fits of rage. Fourthly, in verses 6 and 7, he had a split personality. Fifthly, in verse 7, there was a resistance to spiritual things. Sixthly, also in verse 7, there was excessive sensibility and sensitivity. Seventhly, in verse 9, there was the alteration of voice. And eighth, in verse 13, there was occult transference as the demons moved from the individual to the herd of swine. And it wasn't because the man had one or two of these symptoms that it was clear that he had a demon. He had a massive amount of symptoms, and it was clear that this person had a demon. So these are the symptoms of demonic control. But there's more to say about demonic control, and there's still 4 other points we have to make. The third thing concerning demonic control is causes. What are the causes of demonic control? What causes some people to have a demon residing in them? And from the various passages where we have demonic elements, we can deduct that there are 4 possible causes. One possible cause is that of inheritance. Some people have demonic control because they have inherited it. In Exodus chapter 34, verses 6 and 7, Moses taught that God visits the sins of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the 3rd and 4th generation. Now, that particular sin that God visits to the 3rd and 4th generation is specifically the worship of other gods and the worship of idolatry. And behind idolatry, as we have seen early in our studies on demonology, behind idolatry is specifically the aspect of demonism. Demonism is behind the worship of idolatry. And if there is some form of idolatry, the sin of demonic control can be passed down to the 3rd and 4th generation. Now, idolatry is not limited just to the bowing before statues. Any form of the occult is in essence a form of idolatry because it involves respect for another form of God other than the true God. That is why people that have been involved in the occult will sometimes pass on demonic control to their descendants down to the fourth generation. That's why it is so vital, if a believer is having a great amount of difficulty in a spiritual life, to ask some questions to see if anybody in their family has been involved in any form of occult practices. Have their parents been involved, or grandparents, or great-great-parents, or four generations up? Because it is possible to be demonically controlled by means of inheritance. And in those cases where there has been occult practices 1, 2, 3, or 4 generations back, there must be a prayer of renunciation to break this chain of control. A second cause is the cause of experimentation. Some people experiment with occult things, as a result fall under demonic control, and one example of this is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 14 through 22. God has forbidden any contact with the occult world, and this prohibition must be strictly obeyed. If we begin experimenting with things in the occult world, since the occult world, as we have seen, is under demonic control, that too is a means or a cause by which people have fallen under demonic control. A third cause is transference by contact with the occult. Even when one has not directly been practicing occult, if someone has been somehow involved by contact with it, like observing it, sitting with it when it was being done, there can be demonic transference as a result. And because of this transference, there is demonic control. An example of transference is Mark 5, verse 13. A fourth cause is unconfessed sin. And we see this in the context of Ephesians 4, verse 27. It was in Ephesians 4, 27 that I pointed out early in the series that it is possible for a believer to be in demonic control as well. A believer can be controlled by a demon from within. And as Ephesians 4:27 teaches, a believer is warned against giving a beachhead to the devil. And a beachhead is always an area of control within enemy territory, not without enemy territory. Now the context of Ephesians 4:27 is unconfessed sin. And so the implication is clear that the means by which some have fallen under demonic control is by means of unconfessed sin. So unconfessed sin is another way or a cause by which some have fallen into demonic control. These are four basic causes of demonic control: inheritance, experimentation, transference by contact with the occult, and unconfessed sin. A fourth subject to deal with under demonic control is this issue of the testing of the spirits. I mentioned earlier that we can make certain deductions from a combination of symptoms that I talked about earlier. However, there is also the aspect of testing the spirits because, as I said, even a combination of those symptoms by themselves do not prove that there is demonic control being exercised. So 1 John chapter 4, verse 1 tells us we should be testing the spirits. There are certain tests we can apply to see if it's of the Lord or of a demon. And there are three specific tests the Bible says that we can apply. The first test is in 1 John chapter 4, verses 2 and 3, which is the test of the incarnation. We should ask the question, is Christ come in the flesh? And what that means is, did God become man in the person of Jesus of Nazareth? Now, a demon will deny the incarnation. And if we ask the question, has Jesus Christ come in the flesh? And we're not getting a positive yes answer, then the person has failed the test and that too can imply that there is a demon involved. A second test is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, which is a denial of the lordship of Christ. A denial of the lordship of Christ. And the question that should be asked is this: is Jesus Christ Lord? And by Lord here, it does not mean merely a master who happens to own slaves, but Lord here is in the sense of the Jehovah of the Old Testament. Is Jesus Christ Lord, or the Jehovah of the Old Testament? And if there is a denial of the lordship of Christ, then too we can suspect a demon, because the second test has also been failed. A third test is in 1 John chapter 5, verses 6 and 7, which is a reaction to the blood of Christ. If the person is reacting to the mention of the blood of Christ, this too can show the possibility of demonic problems, because if a person reacts to the mention of the blood of Christ, he is failing a third test. So these are the three tests in testing the spirit: a denial of the incarnation, a denial of the lordship of Christ, and a reaction to the blood of Christ. However, we should keep in mind that these tests must be applied only when it appears that the demon is exercising control, otherwise they will not work. Even when a person has a demon in him, the demon may be lying low. He might not be at that moment exercising direct control. He might be benign. In other words, the demon is still within the person, but the demon at that point is benign. And so it is the person himself that is in control and not the demon at that point. And if you apply these three tests at that point, then the person will indeed pass the test. However, you need to wait till it seems that the demon is in control because of those symptoms. You have a combination of those symptoms I talked about earlier. It is at that point that you need to apply these tests, and at that point it'll be a valid test to see, and if he fails, then that might be a good implication that demons are involved. So again, the test must be applied to the demon when the demon is in control, otherwise the test itself will not work. A fifth point to discuss under demonic control is cures. What are the basic cures for demonic control? Let me just mention five briefly. We will expand on this later in dealing with demonism and the believer. But under this context, let me just mention five cures to demonic control as far as believers are concerned, as well as unbelievers. One cure, which relates to the unbeliever, is receiving Christ. He needs to believe that Jesus is his Savior and accept him. A second cure is confession of sin. Because some people fall under demonic control because of unconfessed sin, then let's confess sin. A third cure is the prayer of renunciation. This involves those that have fallen under demonic control by inheritance, and therefore must pray a prayer of renunciation of any possible control Satan might have because of previous family contacts. Fourthly, there should be the removal of all occult objects, as those practitioners of Acts 19:19 indeed did. If you have any occult objects in your home, like Ouija boards, remove them. And fifthly is resistance, to resist the devil so he will flee from you. And we've talked about demonic control by way of definition, symptoms, causes, testing the spirits, and cures. We'll discuss one more area of demonic control, and that is the area of exorcism, that is, casting a demon out. And in discussing exorcism, let's discuss it by way of 3 points. Number one, examples. The fact that demons can be exorcised or cast out is clearly taught in Scripture by many examples. For example, Jesus himself cast out demons, and we see this a number of times within each gospel. For example, using only the Gospel of Mark, we read of Jesus casting out demons in chapter 1, verses 23 to 27, verses 32 through 34, and verse 39, chapter 3, verses 11 and 12, chapter 5, verses 1 through 20, chapter 7, verses 25 through 30, and Mark chapter 9, verses 17 through 29. We also have the example of the 12 apostles. We see them casting out demons in Matthew 10, verse 1, and Mark 3, verses 14 and 15. Besides the apostolic group of 12, other disciples, such as the 70 disciples, cast out demons in Luke 10, verse 17. And also within the Gospels, we read of others who were not direct followers of Jesus in the sense that they were following him around the land, but were believers in Jesus. We see such casting out demons in Mark 9, verses 38 and 39, and Luke 9, verses 49 and 50. Elsewhere, in the book of Acts, we find Peter doing it in Acts 5:16, Philip in Acts 8:7, and Paul in Acts 16, verses 16 through 18, and Acts 19, verses 11 and 12. So these examples show that demons who reside in people can be forced out. But what is the means? Secondly, in dealing with exorcism, what is the means of casting out demons? And altogether, there are five ways of doing so. The first means is in the name of Jesus Christ, and we are to do it in Christ's name, as we see in Luke 10, verse 17. Secondly, it should be by power of the Holy Spirit. We should not cast demons out in our own name, but in the name of Christ, but also not by our power, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, according to Matthew 12, verse 28. Thirdly, it should be done with a simple word, that is, with a command. We shouldn't have to go through a long ritual to get a demon out. It should be sufficient to simply command a demon to get out with a word, and that word is, get thee hence in the name of Jesus Christ. This we see in Matthew 8, verse 16, and Mark chapter 5, verse 8. Fourthly, we should do it by faith. We should believe that we have the power through Jesus Christ to do so. Maybe not so much the power, but the authority to do so, according to Matthew 17, verses 18 through 20. And there are certain types of demons that we cannot simply order out, especially a demon that causes the person to be mute. In the case of mute or dumb demons, then we should exercise prayer. We should pray that demon out in Mark 9:29. So some demons can be simply ordered out in the name of Christ, by the power of the Spirit, with the word, and on the basis of faith. But there is an exception here and there, and some demons can only be forced out by the prayers of the saints. In such cases, we do not try to get a demon out ourselves by using our authority in the name of Christ, but rather we simply let God do it, and let God do it by means of our prayers. And that is the point of Mark 9:29. Now, I pointed out earlier, when we first began discussing demonic control, that both believers and unbelievers can be controlled by a demon. Now, what about exorcism in relationship to believers and unbelievers? In the case of an unbeliever, he has absolutely no authority whatsoever. In the case of an unbeliever, someone else, that is a believer, needs to force the demon out of an unbeliever, and that is that we simply order the demon out in the name of Christ by the power of the Spirit on the basis of faith, and in certain situations we'll have to pray that demon out. We have to do it because the unbeliever has no authority whatsoever to do it for himself. But that's not the best way to go in the case of a believer that is controlled by a demon. I mentioned earlier that the difference between believers and unbelievers is that the unbeliever can be totally controlled, but I believe it can never be totally controlled by a demon, only partially, because there is always a part of him consistently under God's control. And because one is a believer, he doesn't have to have another believer force the demon out. He can force the demon out himself. And that's why, in dealing with Satan, the believer is encouraged to do one thing, and that is to resist. And the believer is told to resist in James chapter 4, verse 7, and 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9, where he's told to resist in each of these passages once. But in the third passage, Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18, a believer is told to resist Satan three times. So we combine the Ephesians passage with the other two, a total of five different times believers are told to resist Satan. And if a believer resists Satan, he can force the demon out of himself. And the means of doing so is given in the Ephesians passage, which is to be strong in the Lord. Now, what it means to be strong in the Lord is putting on the armor. What it means to put on the armor is to understand our position in Christ, to understand what positional truth is. Because of what we are positionally in Christ, because of what we are by having been baptized into the body of Christ, we have authority. The trouble is that believers don't always know the authority that they have, and because they don't know the authority that they have, they fail to exercise it. So what you need to do is learn your position in Christ and the authority that comes with it. There are 33 things which are true of you if you are a believer in Jesus Christ. The moment you believe, you are baptized by the Holy Spirit into the body of Christ. 33 things happened on that occasion, and all of this carries a degree of authority. I will not go through these 33 things, but at our office we have a list of all of them. Simply drop us a letter asking us for a list of the 33 things, and study them, and learn your position in Christ, and then you'll understand your authority that comes with it. But that is the way a believer needs to deal with a demonic problem from within as well as from without, and that is by understanding his position, exercising his authority, by resisting Satan. Now, this is a good introduction to the 11th part of our study, which has to do with demonism and the believer. Demonism and the believer. Here, let me make four points. Number one, demons oppose saints. There is continuous demonic opposition to the saints, and this demonic opposition to the saints is seen in three ways. Number one, there is general opposition. General opposition that sometimes comes through direct opposition, directly from demons, as in Ephesians 6, verse 12. There's also demonic opposition of believers through unbelievers, as in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2. But one form of demonic opposition is general opposition. A second form is opposition against specific individual believers, as in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 3. There's also a third form of opposition, that is opposition to a body of believers, opposition to the church, as in Revelation 2, verse 24. The first thing about demonism and the believers to keep in mind that there is demonic opposition to the saints in these three ways. A second thing to keep in mind is that God does use demons for the spiritual growth of believers, and God will allow some degree of demonic activity from without, not from within, but from without, for the spiritual growth of believers. And indeed, God used a demon to teach Paul humility in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 7. A third thing to keep in mind concerning believers and demons is that demons were defeated at the cross, according to Colossians 2:15. That means they have no legal authority over us unless we willingly submit to them. But they were defeated. We don't have to obey them. We obey them only if we allow ourselves to fall into one of these demonic traps we spoke about in the past. And fourthly, concerning demonism and the believer, what are the believer's responsibilities in conjunction with demons? Four things. Number one, a believer should learn how to test the spirits, as in 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. Secondly, there should be no consultation and no connection with the occult, in Leviticus 19:31, Deuteronomy 18, verses 9 through 14, Isaiah chapter 8, verse 19. Thirdly, there should be no fellowship with those connected with demonic activity, according to 1 Corinthians 10, verse 20. And fourthly, we should be wearing the armor of God, which is the Scriptures. We should be memorizing and studying the Scriptures, according to Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 18. The 12th division concerning demonology is to discuss briefly the future activities of demons. We've talked about their historical activities and the present activities in the past. What will be the future activities of demons? Concerning future activities of demons, we can divide that into two categories. First, concerning the church. Concerning the church, in the last days, they will spread false doctrine in the church to bring about the great apostasy of the church. And I think this has already been fulfilled nowadays, so that the majority of the visible church today has gone apostate, and that this was predicted as a future activity of demons, we can see clearly in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. A second future activity of demons, a second category I should say, is the Great Tribulation. There will be some tremendous demonic activity in the Great Tribulation. Early in this series, I mentioned that there are specific divisions of history based upon the increase or decrease of demonic activity. The first historical period was the Old Testament period up until the Gospels, in which there was low amount of demonic activity. The second period was the Gospel period, in which there is a tremendous increase of demonic activity. The third time period was from the book of Acts till the Great Tribulation, in which we have demonic activity back on the level of the Old Testament. But the fourth great division of demonic activity in historically is the activity that will come in the Great Tribulation, in which once again there will be a tremendous increase of demonic activity back up the level that it was in the days of the Gospels. And we note concerning demonic activity in the Great Tribulation that at least six specific activities will be performed by demons during the Great Tribulation. At least six specific activities. Number one, there will be two demonic invasion. And number one is this first demonic invasion of Revelation 9, verses 1 through 11. And the purpose of this first demonic invasion will be to torment men greatly but short of inflicting death for 5 months of the Great Tribulation. A second great demonic activity will be that four leading demons, which are now bound at the Euphrates River in Iraq, are going to be loosed. In Revelation 9, verses 13 through 15, the first demonic activity is in chapter 9, verses 1 through 11, and then in verses 13 through 15, we have four leading demons bound at the Euphrates to be released. The reason they are released is in conjunction with the third demonic activity of the Great Tribulation, which is the second great demonic invasion, recorded in Revelation 9, verses 16 through 19. These four leading demons will be leading this great demonic invasion, whereas the four leading demons are bound by the Euphrates River. The demons of the second demonic invasion are bound in the abyss, the place of temporary confinement of fallen angels, and they will be released 200 million demons are going to be released out of the abyss. These are not Chinese, mind you, but demons. And these 200 million demons will be led by these four leading demons for the second demonic invasion. And the purpose of the second demonic invasion is to kill, to destroy, one-third of the humanity of that day. A fourth demonic activity in the Great Tribulation is that men will begin to worship demons on a grand scale, on a greater scale than ever seen in human history. And this is predicted in Revelation 9, verses 20 and 21. A fifth activity of demons in the Great Tribulation is that demons, along with Satan, will be cast out of their present abode, Satan's third abode, which is the atmospheric heavens. They'll be cast out and they'll be confined to the earth, according to Revelation 12, verses 7 through 12. And because demons will be confined to the earth for the second half of the tribulation, this explains why there is such a tremendous increase in demonic activity during the Great Tribulation. Then sixthly, demons will help gather the nations for that final war, the War of Armageddon. Revelation 16, verses 13 and 14 speaks of demons who have frog-like characteristics and features going forth to make sure that nations come together for that final conflict, the campaign of Armageddon. So these are basically the future activities of demons. And so we come to the 13th and final segment of our study on demonology, and that is the doom of demons. What will be the doom of demons? The doom of demons will come in two stages. The first stage is in the millennium. The second stage is in the eternal order, or the eternal state. First of all, the demon confinement in the millennium. The first stage of the doom of demons will be in the millennium, and they will be in a place of confinement. That is the point of Isaiah 24, verses 21 and 22, in which God, Isaiah tells us that he is going to punish the high ones on high, which refers to fallen angelic beings, and they will be put into prison. And so all demons will be confined during the entire millennium so that there'll be no demonic activity whatsoever in the Messianic Kingdom. Now many assume that they'll be confined with Satan in the abyss, but that is not what the Bible teaches. Now Satan himself during the entire Messianic Kingdom will be confined in the abyss. The abyss again is a temporary place of confinement for fallen angels. While many other demons have been confined there, Satan so far has never been confined in the abyss, but he will be in the Messianic Kingdom. But his demons will not be confined there with him. Rather, the demons will be divided into two groups and be confined in two places. The first group of demons will be confined in what is the land of Edom. That was the ancient name. Today it is the southern part of Jordan. And this is emphasized by Isaiah 34, verses 13 through 15, which mentions various animals living in the land of burning pitch and burning brimstone. But little animals like that cannot live in the land of burning pitch and burning brimstone. So these are again demons that have these particular animal-like features. And the first group of demons will be confined in the land of Edom or southern Jordan. A second group of demons will be confined in the city of Babylon within modern-day Iraq. And this is taught by Isaiah chapter 13, verses 21 and 22, and by Revelation 18, verse 2. So all demons will be confined in the millennium, either in Edom or in Babylon. And for this reason, these two sections throughout the kingdom are areas of desolation. and throughout the kingdom they are countries of burning pitch and burning brimstone, with the smoke of the brimstone ascending for the entire 1,000-year period. So while the whole world is beautified and blossoming as the rose, these two areas will be desolated, and demons will be confined into these two areas. No humans will live there, only demons will live there, and so there'll be no demonic activity of any kind. Harassment, influence, or control, there'll be no demonic activity whatsoever throughout the kingdom. Whatever sin is found in the kingdom will be a result of man's human sinful nature, but not because of demonic activity. The second stage of the doom of demons is in the eternal state. And the doom of demons in the eternal state itself will come in two phases. First of all, every demon will be judged at the great white throne judgment, and these demons will be judged by believers. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 3, Paul points out that we shall someday judge the angels. Now, he cannot be referring to good angels. Good angels never sin, they never fail in their missions, and so they don't need to undergo a judgment. The angels that Paul is speaking about is fallen angels, which are demons. At the great white throne judgment, then, all demons will stand for judgment to determine their each individual degree of punishment. And remember, we taught earlier that there are degrees of wickedness among demons. Not all demons have the same degree of wickedness, so there will be degrees of punishment even for demons, and that decree will be determined by believers. And then after the great white throne judgment will come the second phase, and that is to be cast into the lake of fire. And all demons will spend eternity in the lake of fire, according to Matthew 8, verse 29, and Matthew chapter 25, verse 41 and verse 46. And so with this, our lengthy series on demonology comes to an end. We bid you shalom.